There's an old saying in Tennessee, I know it's in Texas, probably in Tennessee, that says, fool me once, shame on you. If fool me, we can't get fooled again.
Everybody's got to be covered. This is an un-Republican thing for me to say.
Universal health care.
I am going to take care of everybody.
Well, who pays for it?
The government's going to pay for it.
This tax would raise approximately $5.7 trillion.
In many cases, I probably identify more as a Democrat.
I hate the concept of guns. I'm not in favor of it.
Why are you joining the Reform Party?
I really believe the Republicans are just too crazy right. I mean, hey, I lived in New York City and Manhattan all my life, okay? So, you know, my views are a little bit different than if I lived in Iowa, perhaps.
Partial birth abortion. Would President Trump ban partial birth abortion?
Well, look, I'm very pro-choice.
But you would not ban it?
No.
Or ban partial birth abortion?
No, I would. I am pro-choice in every respect.
This is an un-Republican thing for me to say.
Who do you think would be the best qualified to make a deal with Iran?
Hillary's always surrounded herself with very good people. I think Hillary would do a good job.
Make a deal with Iran.
Well, I think Hillary would do a good job.
Nancy Pelosi, the speaker.
And I'm very impressed by her. I think she's a very impressive person. I like her a lot.
Well, I thought he did a great job tonight. I thought he was strong and smart, and it looks like we have somebody that knows what he's doing. And it's a strong guy who really knows what he wants, and this is what we need.
Hillary's a great friend of mine. Her husband is a great friend of mine. I think Hillary is going to take it, and I think Hillary is very, very capable.
I'm very pro-choice,
a liberal in health care.
Universal health coverage.
I like universal.
As far as single payer, it works in Canada. It works incredibly well in Scotland.
It just seems that the economy does better under the Democrats than the Republicans.
Donald Trump and I both agree that there ought to be more taxation.
What do you think of eminent domain?
I think it's a wonderful thing. I'll be honest with you.
He was basically a Democrat.
Shortly before Trump announced his decision to run, he received a mysterious phone call from Bill Clinton.
I didn't get a phone call from Bill Clinton before I jumped in the race. Did any of you get a phone call from Bill Clinton? I didn't. Maybe it's because I hadn't given money to the foundation or donated to his wife's Senate campaign.
Until recently, Trump praised the Clintons, his longtime personal friends, every chance he got.
Hillary Clinton, I think, is a terrific woman. I mean, I'm a little biased because I've known her for years.
You support her?
I don't want to get into this because I'll get myself into trouble, but I just like her. I like her, and I like her husband.
Hillary's always surrounded herself with very good people. I think Hillary would do a good job.
That's not surprising given his generous donations to Clinton Senate campaigns and to the Clinton Foundation.
Actually, it was vintage Trump, you know. He has been, believe it or not, uncommonly nice to Hillary and me. He thought Hillary was a good senator for New York after 9/11.
Right.
And he's one of the many Republicans who supported our foundation before they got the memo.
Not only has Trump bankrolled Hillary, he's also supported Democrats like Chuck Schumer, Harry Reid, and Anthony Weiner, amongst others. Notice how Fox failed to nail Trump on his key weakness, the fact that he's flip-flopped on just about every issue imaginable.
Well, I'm very pro-life and feel strongly about it.
I'm very pro-choice.
Since he has changed his mind on amnesty, on health care, and on abortion, I would just ask, what are the principles by which he will govern?
And yes, in many ways, Trump is likable. He's a great public speaker. He makes populist statements that other politicians are afraid to say. But I think we've been down that road before, and it didn't turn out so good.
Yes, we can.
Trump's whole shtick is posing as an anti-establishment candidate, but his cozy relationship with the Clintons clearly suggests he's the opposite of that.
He buys and sells politicians of all stripes. He's already, he's already hedging his bet on the Clintons, okay? So if he doesn't run as a Republican, maybe he supports Clinton, or maybe he runs as an independent.
Okay.
But I'd say that he's already hedging his bets because he's used to buying politicians.
How do we let him get away with it, folks?
You mentioned recently that you're a Christian, that you go to church. How important is your faith to Donald Trump?
Very important. I'm a Protestant. I'm a Presbyterian.
Well, maybe because of the fact that I'm a strong Christian and I feel strongly about it, and maybe there's a bias.
In his 2000 book, Think Big and Make It Happen in Business and Life,
Donald Trump boasts of having had sex with some of the, quote, top women in the world. An article in the New York Post referred to the candidate for president as, quote, a well-known womanizer. Trump did not refute the claim.
And I won't get into the filth of his conversation with Billy Bush that Christians, along with the rest of Trump supporters, so flippantly and eagerly dismissed as locker room talk. Oh, he's not without his flaws, they said, but he's far better than Hillary. I would ask, in what way exactly? Can you articulate a moral argument? Or is it all economic? All I have to say is, if he was talking about your wife or sister or daughter, you know as well as I do, you would be beyond angry and expect everyone to agree he is a scumbag. But we aren't electing a pastor, right?
After leaving one wife after another and marrying a younger model, Trump chose his third and present wife, Slovenian immigrant Milena Knaus, a woman who has posed nude for a European men's magazine. The Trump Taj Mahal Casino in Atlantic City was a first, boasting a 35,000-square-foot adult entertainment complex with both female and male strippers, pole dancers, and lap dancers. Many of Trump's supporters think he stands for biblical marriage, but homosexual activists know better. Gregory Angelo, president of the Log Cabin Republicans, a homosexual advocacy group, is cited in a CNN article saying Donald Trump is, quote, one of the best, if not the best, pro-gay Republican to ever run for the presidency.
You're not going to raise that f***ing price. You understand me?
So those factories are cheap as and they don't give a s***. Listen, you motherfuckers, we're going to tax you 25%.
Have you ever asked God for forgiveness? That's a tough question. I don't think in terms of, I'm a religious person. Shockingly, because people are so shocked when they find this out, I'm Protestant, I'm Presbyterian, and I go to church and I love God and I love my church. And Norman Vincent Peale, the great Norman Vincent Peale, was my pastor. The power of positive thinking. Everybody's heard of Norman Vincent Peale. He was so great. He would give a sermon, you never wanted to leave. Sometimes we have sermons and every once in a while we think about leaving a little early, right, even though we're Christian. Dr. Norman Vincent Peale, Frank, would give a sermon. I'm telling you, I still remember his sermons. It was unbelievable. And what he would do is he'd bring real life situations, modern day situations, into the sermon. And you could listen to him all day long. When you left the church, you were disappointed that it was over. He was the greatest guy. And then, you know, he passed away, but he was a great, he wrote The Power of Positive Thinking, which is a great book. But have you ever asked God for forgiveness? I'm not sure I have. I just go and try and do a better job from there. I don't think so. I think if I do something wrong, I think I just try and make it right. I don't bring God into that picture. I don't.
Pause for a moment and reflect on what Trump is really communicating here. In first attempting to dodge the question of whether he ever asked God's forgiveness, Trump divulges that the one so-called Christian he holds in high esteem is one of the most influential 33rd degree Freemasons who ever lived, who, given the very nature of the higher Masonic degrees, is no real Christian at all, but rather a Luciferian. And then, like any other proud-hearted son of the devil, Trump acknowledges he never believes he does wrong, despite all the immorality he is engaged in, and that he has no intention of bowing the knee before God to ask his forgiveness.
Now, when I take, you know, when we go in church and when I drink my little wine, which is about the only wine I drink, and have my little cracker, I guess that's a form of asking for forgiveness. And I do that as often as possible because I feel cleansed. And
so for forgiveness, that notion of forgiveness, that's not a central
tenet. Well, I try
for
not
you.
To make mistakes where I have to ask for forgiveness, for one thing. So when I'm asked a question like that, it's like, you know, I don't like to make a lot of mistakes.
So, and I would never ask the detail, but the idea of repentance, is that something that's important to you?
I think repenting is terrific.
But do you feel the need to?
If I make a mistake, yeah, I think it's great. But I try not to make mistakes. I mean, why do I have to, you know, repent? Why do I have to ask for forgiveness if you're not making mistakes? I work hard. I'm an honorary.
The cusp of a new epoch, one of prophecy, puzzles, and signs in the sky. And that epoch begins today.
Go, it's like a conspiracy.
A conspiracy, eh?
Freemasons run the country! Freemasons run the country!
It's like a conspiracy.
A conspiracy, eh?
Freemasons run the country! Freemasons run the country!
You'll see that how this man never changed. He does not repent. He only changes what he says, like a chameleon, for political expediency. He does what he has to do and says what he has to say to get where he has to go. People keep saying how he's uncontrolled, what an outsider he is, how he says what he thinks. He says what itching ears want to hear, and plays to people's emotions, and gives voice to those who want to stick to the opposition, whose allegiance is more to vengeance than to truth, who are blinded by their frustration and marginalization to seeing that they are being used as pawns in a game, always, always, always advancing the agenda of the Antichrist beast system.
Just to button this up very quickly, sir, are you saying that if you become president, you might try to appoint justices to overrule the decision on same-sex marriage?
I would strongly consider that, yes.
One of the groups that's expressing fear of the LGBTQ group.
I mentioned them at the Republican National Convention. And
you did.
Everybody said, that was so great. I have been, you know, I've been a supporter.
Well, I guess the issue for them is marriage equality. Oh. Do you support marriage equality?
It's irrelevant because it was already settled. It's law. It was settled in the Supreme Court. I mean, it's done.
So even if you appoint a judge that...
It's done. These cases have gone to the Supreme Court. They've been settled. And I'm fine with that.
Please be specific. Tell us your views on LGBT, how you plan to be inclusive as president. Speak about North Carolina bathroom law in particular.
Oh, I had a feeling that question was going to come up. I will tell you. Well, look, North Carolina did something that was very strong, and they're paying a big price, and there's a lot of problems. And I heard one of the best answers I heard was from a commentator yesterday saying, leave it the way it is right now. There have been not very few problems. Leave it the way it is. North Carolina, what they're going through with all of the business that's leaving and all of the strife, and that's on both sides. You leave it the way it is. There have been very few complaints the way it is. People go, they use the bathroom that they feel is appropriate. There has been so little trouble. And the problem with what happened in North Carolina is the strife and the economic punishment that they're taking.
So if Caitlyn Jenner were to walk into Trump Tower
and want to use the bathroom, you would be fine with her using any bathroom she chooses.
That is correct.
Okay.
Of course, when notified that this stance might be make or break with much of the evangelical base that they wanted to make sure back Trump, Donald backed down, saying he would let the states decide the issue.
Different issue, also a social issue.
You know, there's a big move to create new bathrooms. Problem with that is for transgender. That would be a, first of all, I think that would be discriminatory in a certain way. It would be unbelievably expensive for businesses and for the country. Leave it the way it is.
Let's talk about abortion, another potent social issue. The Republican platform every 4 years has a provision that states that the right of the unborn child shall not be infringed, and it makes no exceptions for rape, for incest, for the life of the mother. Would you want to change the Republican platform to include the exceptions
yes,
that you have?
I would. Yes, I would. Absolutely, for the three exceptions.
Would you have an exception for the health of the mother?
I would leave it for the life of the mother, but I would absolutely have the three exceptions.
Far from being truly pro-life, even in his flip-flops since becoming a Republican, Donald Trump clearly believes we should murder children for the crimes of their fathers. And the religious right will accept this like they compromise on everything else. The only ones they have the guts to really stand up against are those who tell them the truth of how their continuous compromising is the real reason the country is in the state it's in.
Huge issue is Wall Street banks. You're a guy who said you know the Wall Street bankers better than anyone.
Better than anyone.
All right, after the 2008 financial meltdown, do you think any of the guys you know better than anyone should have been in jail?
The answer is if they did something purposely illegal, the answer is absolutely yes. Better than anyone.
But let's watch you duck, dodge, and deflect away from condemning those who you truly represent, the class of criminals above the law, too big to fail, too high up the chain to prosecute, the high-level mammon worshippers, the enemies of the Republic.
Now, with all of that being said, I don't believe anybody has really been indicted and gone to jail, which is pretty amazing, because I'm sure there were some pretty bad moves made. I will say this. A lot of mistakes were made. You can't put a businessman in jail because he made a bad business decision. You know?
No one is calling for putting people in prison for bad business decisions. Where the outcry comes from is seeing real, verifiable crimes having been committed, costing real citizens their hard-earned savings, and the worst anyone is punished is by being fined by the corrupt Department of Justice. Fines the banks then pay under the very corporate welfare government stimulus money they were rewarded with for their willful, negligent fraud perpetuated against the American people.
You know, they want to do well, and for the most part, Wall Street bankers want to do well. I know so many of them. You know so many of them. They want to do well. They're good people, like everyone else. Get a lot of money. I think they're paid too much money, but what are you going to do? I mean, you know, it's one of those things.
If they
make a business mistake, you can't put people in jail. If they do something that they know is illegal and wrong, you got to put them in jail.
Does it ever surprise you that so many of your supporters are so angry at those banks because they feel the decks are stacked against them, and yet you're the guy they're supporting, and you're a guy who's been given every single advantage those banks can give to the wealthiest Americans?
Well, I have taken advantage of the banks probably more than any human being on earth. I love banks, right? I love banks. And I love fighting with banks if I have to. I mean, you know, depends on what happens. The economy goes up, it goes down. But I found bankers to be very good people. I found them to be very honorable people. Generally speaking, they want to do what's right for the country.
Fraud and potential criminal conduct were at the heart of the financial crisis.
Titans of Wall Street.
No one going to jail, no individuals being held accountable.
Too big to jail.
A pervasively corrupt pattern of behavior.
More than 90% of the underlying loans were defective.
Isn't that fraudulent?
Yes.
This is a stain on the American justice system.
I found bankers to be very good people. I found them to be very honorable people. Generally speaking, they want to do what's right for the country. They want to do well. They're good people.
Good, honorable people, because they do what is profitable for those who are part of the big club, of which Donald is most certainly a member.
I found it interesting, though, that Donald Trump's also Jesuit trained.
Jesuit trained at Fordham, and he's also 33rd degree Freemason.
Yeah.
There's no way you're going to recover from three or four bankruptcies without being in with the big boys, restoring your credit in New York. And all those guys are the Knights of Malta and the big banks.
They're good people.
I very much look forward to dealing with the president in the future, including counsel, to explain some of the difficulties, some of the high-flying assets, and some of the really great things that have been achieved. So, Mr. President, it was a great honor being with you, and I look forward to being with you many, many more times in the future. Thank you, sir.
Very good man.
Thank you, guys. Appreciate it.
Yes, and there was a question that was answered, George. At the end there, I asked Donald Trump if he was really going to seek the president's counsel, and that's when he responded at the very end saying, he is a very good man. Those were words that I hadn't expected to hear from Donald Trump, covering him all over these years. He talked about how he had respect for him, and he hoped to see him many, many more times in the future. Even made a reference, George, you heard there, to some of the excellent things that have been accomplished. So this was apparently a quite cordial meeting. As Trump mentioned, it lasted for an hour and a half.
And John, interesting that he's going to seek President Obama's counsel, given the fact that so many of his promises on the campaign trail are to undo many of President Obama's accomplishments in his first 100 days in office.
Well, and also given the unbridled animosity that we have seen between the two men. As you mentioned, Donald Trump questioned whether or not the president was even a citizen of the United States and therefore eligible to be president of the United States. And President Obama made no bones about the fact that he believed that Donald Trump was temperamentally unfit to be commander-in-chief. Now we see the two of them quite cordial words from each man. The president saying he is bound and determined to try to help Donald Trump be a successful president, a successful transition, because he thinks that will be that would mean success for the country as a whole. And this extraordinary statement from Donald Trump that he will be seeking counsel from a man he once said was not a legitimate president.
Very good man.
Thank you, Gravis. Appreciate it.
Very good man.
Thank you, Gravis. Appreciate it.
Well, Mr. Trump is a friend of yours.
Yes.
I think you would. I know him casually. He's obviously playing some sort of character.
He's got a part here. The part is he's running for president.
Yes, exactly.
People who appear to be in opposition politically or financially or industrially or in many ways are working together. You'll find that men in the same society will take opposite positions in public. The method they use is that of the Hegelian dialectic. Thesis played against antithesis leads to a synthesis. In other words, for Hegel, for history to make progress, you have to have conflict. And when you look at the key people in the order, you will find that they generate conflict. So Bush and Harriman politically are conflicting. Coffin and Buckley, although part of the same order, are in public conflicting with one another because conflict leads to the new synthesis. In other words, at that level, politics disappears and people often wonder, why does a Democrat join a Republican administration? They want to acquire power above all.
Power?
Political
to do what?
Power. As you look at their actions, the political power is to bring about what they call a new world order, which is a one world. But they use the Hegelian techniques, and we know enough about Hegel to know that not only does this mean the dialectic process, the creation of conflict, but it also means that individuals such as you and I, or anybody watching this program, will be cogs in the state, that we have no individual rights. Our individual rights for Hegel, come about through obedience to the state. We see it in the educational process, that we have adopted what I call a Hegelian system of education, which is not to bring out your innate talents, but to prepare you to be an individual cog in the state.
After the results were becoming clear, we saw the stock market futures drop by almost 1,000 points, 850 points or so. And then Donald Trump made that very conciliatory acceptance speech, and stocks started to go up. And then Hillary Clinton and the president made their very conciliatory speeches yesterday, and the market soared.
Do you see what they're telling you here? What is being implied between the lines? That were Trump an actual outsider ready to shake things up and tear down the Fed and give the American people their economy back and truly overthrow globalism, like he used alternative media puppets like Alex Jones to infer, the markets would have plunged. an economic collapse would have ensued. But since Trump came out and showed that far from draining the swamp, he was controlled opposition ready to play ball and further the globalist aims, the market soared again. And since they have convinced people on both sides of the false paradigm that economy and security is first and foremost and that financial prosperity is to be valued above all else, they subliminally tie a sense of well-being and seeing the markets go up to seeing globalists who have acted as enemies for political expediency come together for the good of the country.
As I say, crooked Hillary, crooked Hillary. She's as crooked as they come.
Hillary has worked very long and very hard over a long period of time, and we owe her a major debt of gratitude for her service to our country. I mean that very sincerely.
I think he's the worst president maybe in the history of our country. I think he's been a disaster. He's been weak. He's been ineffective.
Senator, it was a great honor being with you, and I look forward to being with you many, many more times in the future. Thank you, sir.
He's not going to prosecute any of these people. All those WikiLeaks and other supposed leaks, like the one where Hillary was quoted as saying that if Donald won, her and her minions would all be swinging from a noose. It was all mind control to get you to accept Donald as an outsider. But listen to the man. He tells you exactly what he's about every time he opens his mouth, if you are able to read past the doublespeak to what he is really telling you. Obama, Hillary, Newt Gingrich, and the rest of the neocons, who will fill up his cabinet, the Heritage Foundation, and all the other Vatican-controlled figureheads of the religious right, are his people. People who mouth the virtues of the Republic while working toward globalism at every turn. As patriotic as the Patriot Act. It's like a working man going to court expecting his attorney will actually fight to exonerate him. But the attorney goes out to breakfast with the DA and hobnobs with the judge and comes back telling his client how it would be in his best interest to accept a plea bargain because he is very unlikely to win if he fights. The working man doesn't understand how the game is played. The working man has paid the attorney, but the attorney doesn't really represent him. And why would he? He has to work with the DA and the judge over and over again. And the working man is just another hump going through the machine. Cattle to be milked and sheep to be fleeced. The allegiance in the mammon machine is never to truth or justice. Principles don't make money. In fact, a lot of the time, they can cost you money. And, as is plainly obvious, Donald's moral compass is whatever is financially profitable is what is right.
I will build a great, great wall on our southern border, and I will have Mexico pay for that wall. Yeah. Mark my words. Yeah.
These people, your people, these people are taking our jobs.
You know what? That's a myth, Charlie. That really is a myth. Because the reality today is that nobody wants to work in agriculture any longer. It's not an American job any longer. We did a campaign a few years ago, 3 years ago, and we invited people, said, we called the campaign, take our jobs. People were calling us up and they were asking, well, is there a limousine that's gonna come pick me up for work? Is there air conditioning in the fields, Charlie? I mean, those are the kinds of things that they were asking. Pensions, you know, what are the wages like? And out of the hundreds of thousands of people that responded, 11 people actually went to go work in the fields, and none of them endured.
So tired, I'm missing my own bag. I don't feel it in my leg, but boy, right in my lower back. I tell you, there and in my forearms, just from like this repetitive motion of like. So one of the workers asked me, he said, well, what do you think it would take for an American to come out here and do this job? And I think it would take like $30 an hour. Guaranteed, like not even based on the buckets that they get. And then when you'd go to the grocery store, your orange juice would cost $12. Because after being here, I tell you what, I don't think most of you would do this job. That's the fact. And so now if you look what I made today, I only finished three bins, $28.50, $285 an hour over 10 hours. Imagine like having to do this every day, 6 days a week for your whole life.
Blessing.
Very hard.
How many?
Three and two-thirds.
Not too bad.
Not too bad.
For a first day.
But not too good.
I know.
Yeah, not too good.
1,800 pounds of grapes a day. But before you apply, you ought to know that rules regarding overtime, minimum wage, and workers' comp often do not apply to farm workers.
In California, you get paid by the hour in some places, but in most places in the country, you get paid by the amount of work you do. That's why most farm workers don't make minimum wage. Come take the job.
Huh? What do you need?
I split my knee open with a skill saw, and I'm gonna go try and file for disability so I can get my GA assistance.
Get some welfare, you need some change to get to the welfare office?
Yes, sir, I do.
Well, I know where there's work.
Well, right now I can't because I'm gonna have to file for disability.
In California's Central Valley, agriculture is worth $50 billion a year. This farmer tells me he needs imported laborers. The Americans he's hired, he says, are bums. There is legislation in Washington to fix the farm worker problem, but that legislation is dying from cowardice.
Americans won't do that type of work. That work is just, it's out of the cards. They just won't do it. You have to import people to do our work, and this is the biggest agricultural valley in the world. It's we need help.
They think the work is so hard until they just turn around and they up and quit.
On the farm fields of Alabama, the verdict is in. The state's tough immigration law just isn't working out.
They're putting Alabamans back to work in my area. Experience I've had, they ain't too good at what they do.
Keith Smith says most immigration workers left after the law took effect, so this potato farmer hired Americans. Problem is, he says, most show up late, work slower, and are ready to head home after lunch. Some even quit after just one day out in the field.
There's a Hispanic man that works for us, and I say, you know, he's 52, and he'll make anywhere from $70 to $100 a day. I said, if you can keep up with him and do a good job, you can make that. But they just... they're not physically in shape to do it, and, you know, probably not mentally tough enough to do it, some of them.
Over on this tomato farm, the story's not much different. Brent Smith may be the only exception.
The bending over, and if you're not used to working and kneeling down and bending over and constantly up and down all day long, is the grueling part of it. It really is. I mean, other than that, it's not any harder than anything else you do.
With a 9.9 unemployment rate, Alabama is almost 1% higher than the national average. Tomato farmers say skilled workers can make anywhere from $200 to $300 a day, but unskilled workers make much less. And farmers say many Americans are not physically fit and simply don't work fast enough.
It's just going to take body conditioning, mental conditioning, in order to earn enough money to make it worth a day's work.
Politicians who support the law say over time more unemployed Americans will fill these jobs. They insist it's still too early to consider the law a failure.
But when only five pickers showed up this morning to harvest his sweet potatoes, farmer Keith Smith saw possible ruin, the loss of his $500,000 crop.
They're running scared because of this new law.
And you're in trouble.
I'm in trouble, bad trouble. Yeah.
Smith's 200 acres need 20 pickers, mostly Mexican nationals.
There is not enough documented people here to supply that workforce.
Most of your workers are here illegally.
That's sure. If they got documentation, they got a better job working for me.
Farmers gathering for lunch at the local diner are worried.
Putting us out of business. Plain and simple.
With the Hispanic workforce embedded in the economy, there are predictions the law could cost Alabama as much as $10 billion in lost economic growth if people flee.
Fernando Aldemán, a Mexican national, has worked Smith's farm since 1992.
Everybody's just scared.
Yeah.
Now, are you here legally? No.
No.
So, are you scared?
Yeah, I'm scared. I'm scared, you know.
Smith's pickers make about $100 a day. He supports immigration laws, just not this one that threatens his third-generation family farm.
You want to get rid of illegal immigrants? Quit eating. And that's for everybody. That's, you know, nationwide. If you want to get rid of them, quit eating. That'll solve the problem.
Trump knows curtailing illegal immigration would be crippling to the American economy. Like it or not, the farmer makes a valid point. Want to stop illegal immigration? Stop eating. There's a reason you can go to Walmart and get you a watermelon for just $5. So being that it is not economically viable, I wouldn't expect Trump to be as tough on illegal immigration as he sounded on the campaign trail. Or maybe this is how the globalists plan to bring America to her knees, get her to basically cripple herself with no one to blame but Trump and those who voted him in. I try to view the immigration issue through the lens of Scripture. On one hand, given the biblical mandate to be subject to the governing authorities, except if the government's laws violates God's word, I would agree with the following quote. Illegal immigration is the breaking of a government's law. There is nothing in Scripture that contradicts the idea of a sovereign nation having immigration laws. Therefore, it is rebellion against God to unlawfully enter another country. Illegal immigration is a sin. On the other hand, I believe this sin is between the individual and God, and my response to those who are here illegally should be one of justice and compassion. Lawbreakers ought to be punished, but there must be a way of fast-tracking those who have been here peaceably for years and or come here to work, to either citizen status or a work visa. The Bible is quite clear about the treatment of migrants, regardless of citizenship status. Exodus 22:21. You shall not wrong a sojourner or oppress him. Leviticus 19:33-34. When a stranger sojourns with you in your land, you shall not do him wrong. You shall treat the stranger who sojourns with you as the native among you, and you shall love him as yourself. Matthew 25:35-38. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me drink. I was a stranger, and you welcomed me. And the king will answer them, truly I say to you, as you did it to one of the least of these my brothers, you did it to me. And it is imperative we understand why people from numerous countries south of our border, not just Mexico, are coming to the U.S. in search of a better life or to make provision for themselves and their families when they return to their own lands. While two wrongs never make a right, it must be said that some of the darkest and furthest reaching sins in the history of mankind are inherent to what our government and shadow government has done all throughout Latin America through the 50s, 60s, 70s, and 80s in assassinating duly elected leaders and staging coups to overthrow governments in order to install fascist dictators and warlords under our employ.
My expertise, as you know, is CIA, Marine Corps, three CIA secret wars. I had a position in the National Security Council in 1975 as the chief of the Angola task force running the secret war in Angola. It was the third CIA secret war I was part of. The national security law creating the National Security Council and the CIA, as you know, was passed in 1947. The CIA was given this charter to perform such other duties and function as might be necessary to the national security interests, and given a vague authority to protect its sources and methods. And I think it was in the mid-80s that I coined this phrase, the Third World War, because in my research I realized that we were not attacking the Soviet Union and the CIA's activities, we were attacking people in the Third World. And I'm going to just quickly, in the interest of time, just give you a little sense of what that means, this Third World War. Basically, it's the third, I believe, in terms of loss of life and human destruction, the third bloodiest war in all of history. They undertake to run operations in every corner of the globe. They also undertook the license of operating just totally above and beyond U.S. laws. They had a license, if you will, to kill, but also they took that to a license to smuggle drugs, a license to do all kinds of things to other people in other societies in violation of international law, our law, and every principle of nations working together for a healthier and more peaceful world. Meanwhile, again, they battled to convert the U.S. legal system in such a way that it would give them control of our society. Now, we have massive documentation of what they call the secret wars of the CIA. We don't have to guess or speculate. We had the Church Committee investigate them in 1975, gave us our first really in-depth, powerful look inside this structure. Senator Church said in the 14 years before he did his investigation that he found they had run 900 major operations and 3,000 minor operations. And if you extrapolate that over the whole period of the 40-odd years that we've had a CIA, you come up with 3,000 major operations and over 10,000 minor operations. Every one of them illegal, every one of them disruptive of the lives and societies of other peoples, and many of them bloody and gory beyond comprehension almost. Extensively, we manipulated and organized the overthrow of functioning constitutional democracies in other countries. We organized secret armies and directed them to fight in just about every continent in the world. We encouraged ethnic minorities to rise up and fight, people like the Mosquito Indians in Nicaragua, the Kurds in the Middle East, the Hmongs in Southeast Asia. We have organized, and we still do, and fund death squads in countries around the world, like the Treasury Police in El Salvador, which are responsible for most of the killing of the 50,000 people just in the 80s, and there was 70,000 before that. Trying to summarize this third world war that the CIA, the U.S. National Security Complex, with the military all interwoven in it in many different ways, has been waging. Let me just put it this way. The best heads that I coordinate with studying this thing, we count at least, minimum figure, 6 million people who've been killed in this long 40-year war that we've waged against the people of the Third World. These are not Soviets. We have not been parachuting teams into the Soviet Union to kill and hurt and maim people, especially not since 1954, when they developed actually a capability of dropping atomic weapons on the United States. They aren't British, French, Swedes, Swiss, Belgians. We don't do bloody, gory operations in the countries of Europe. These are all people of the Third World. They're people of countries like the Congo, Vietnam, Kampuchea, Indonesia, Nicaragua, where conspicuously they nor their governments do not have the capability of doing any physical hurt to the United States. They don't have ICBMs. They don't have armies or navies. They could not hurt us if they wanted to. There has rarely been any evidence that they really wanted to. And that, in fact, is perhaps the whole point. If they had had ICBMs, we probably wouldn't have done the things to them for fear of retaliation. Cheap shots, if you will, killing people of other countries of the world who cannot defend themselves under the guise of secrecy and under the rubric of national security.
Despite Reagan's denials, investigations soon revealed that arms had been traded for hostages held in the Mideast.
A few months ago, I told the American people I did not trade arms for hostages. My heart and my best intentions still tell me that's true, but the facts and the evidence tell me it is not.
Only days later, it was further revealed that the arms to Iran had been severely marked up. Some of the profits had been illegally diverted to support the Contras, a guerrilla force organized by the CIA fighting the Nicaraguan government.
To think of the democratic governments that have been overthrown in the last 30 years by military coups is almost like giving a capsule history of CIA covert operations in the last 30 years. I mean, there was the overthrow of Prime Minister Mossadegh in Iran in 1953. There was the overthrow of Arbenz in Guatemala in 1954. There was the overthrow of the Brazilian government in 1964. There was the overthrow of the Ghana government in 1966. A lot of the governments I've just mentioned got into trouble with the international oil companies because they tried to assert their national prerogatives over their own resources. Time after time, the CIA has come in on behalf of those multinational companies.
Anytime you walk the streets in Salvador, you can't tell what kind of eyes you meet. 'Cause when
organized and trained by the CIA.
That squad man can walk and sing the way you do.
Not an indigenous force inside Nicaragua that had any support from any of the population in Nicaragua. It was a total artifice. It was created by these men.
Men who kill have heroes that play soccer too and argue with their kids about the world.
The tactics used by the Contras were tactics of terrorizing civilians.
In the late afternoon of December 4th, 1980, an unmarked grave was found in a field in El Salvador.
In a country where our faces look the same, fear's the poker game that runs the town. When your best friend disappears, who's to be blamed? Think they know.
Teaches commando operations, sniper training, how to fire an M16, and psychological warfare.
They moved away to see the women kneeling down on the ground to pray. They killed all of them. Not a single one of them survived. Just me, by the grace of God. I hid under a tree. When I heard the screams of the children, and I knew which ones were mine, they were crying, "Mommy, they're killing us."
Over 900 men, women, and children were massacred. Virtually the entire population of the village and the area surrounding El Mozote. Out of 143 bodies identified in the laboratory, 131 were of children under the age of 12, including three infants under the age of 3 months. 10 of the 12 officers cited as responsible for the El Mozote massacre were graduates of the School of the Americas.
They are, in fact, giving the Contras written instructions in violence and destabilization. The target is the people. The social and economic infrastructure is what you're hitting at. The purpose is to disseminate terror, traumatize the people. We're not killing Sandinistas in the capital. We're not blowing up their homes and terrorizing them. We're hitting at the people throughout the interior of the country.
Do you think the Iran-Contra scandal will have an effect on future government operations?
No, I think it will be more the same.
I don't think that it's going to have much of an effect at all. I just think that they'll be more careful next time.
They will continue to carry on covert operations. I think this has been going on forever.
They make laws which are for us
that they don't seem to be able to, they don't apply them to themselves very often.
And who is going to inhibit them? The gangsters that are running this country is going to inhibit somebody.
And then in the 90s to the present day, in fixing elections for globalists to lead those countries and go along with our government's so-called free trade policies that are anything but actually free, and have crippled the third world and relegated to sweatshop and plantation status as the workforce to supply U.S. consumerism with all of our inexpensive goods we have come to take for granted as our right as the so-called greatest nation on earth, which in many ways we are, and in many ways we certainly are not, or have only achieved our status through deception and degradation.
In Mexico, the presidential elections are a matter of tremendous controversy. Tens of thousands of people have been in the streets saying the elections were stolen.
The election has been challenged for many months now because the mass media in Mexico, led by Televisa, the big TV monopoly, or part of a duopoly actually, was coming out in favor constantly for one candidate, the candidate who supposedly triumphed in the July 1 presidential election, Peña Nieto. And it was broadcasting false news about his main contender, López Obrador, because it was clear that governing party couldn't win after all the deaths, 60,000 people killed in a phony narco war in the last 6 years, caused a lot of people to be upset. Peña Nieto has spent between 10 and 13 times more than the legal limit established by law on his campaign. The legal limit is $26 million, and 10 or 13 times that is hundreds of millions of dollars. In addition, the charge by López Obrador against this fraudulent election of Peña Nieto, this rigged election, if you will, is that 5 million votes were bought directly with that extra money that was sloshing around in the campaign. And bribing poor people in the rural areas and better off people in the suburbs, particularly the home state of Peña Nieto, Mexico state, where he had been governor and had overseen a very violent regime that repressed workers and peasants. Apparently it bought about a million votes just in his home state alone, where he won as a result. And 5 million votes total when his margin of alleged victory was 3 million. But you know, for most Mexicans, this is sort of a standard operational procedure. Their elections have been fraudulent for years now. That's why they threw out the PRI in 2000. They had a mass movement in the streets for democracy, for real democracy as opposed to fraudulent democracy. And that movement was succeeding when they elected a president in 1988 whose election was taken away by Salinas. And Salinas came into power at that point, consolidated all the alliances with the narco gangs, consolidated the alliances with the U.S. economic interests and oil interests in Mexico, and has Salinas himself was caught, by the way, in a series of illegalities, not only in the 88 election, but as president over the next 6 years. He had to flee. Justice.
Right.
Go live in England for a while. He's back in Mexico now, apparently pulling a lot of the strings behind the scenes for this campaign.
James, the underlying struggle here is that, and I guess my question is, will the Mexican elite, which has done so well with this neoliberal economics and free trade, and you know some of the richest billionaires in the world have emerged in Mexico, are they going to allow any legal process that would bring in López Obrador, who at least in terms of his campaign promises, wants an alternative to this kind of neoliberal economics?
Yeah, he's running against neoliberal economics, and it's not even a socialist program or anything of the kind. It's just a sort of moderate capitalism, a more humane capitalism that he's advocating. And, of course, protection of the nation's national resources, particularly oil, most of which has already been delivered indirectly to the U.S. and other foreign companies. So he's sort of a nationalist, moderate centrist, left of center. But the elites, as you say, will not allow him in. And so that's why in the previous presidential election that he ran in 6 years ago, López Obrador won by everyone's testimony, and it's been documented, including in my new book, Mexico's Revolution Then and Now. And yet he was not allowed to take office. Calderon came in from the conservative PAN party and unleashed the military on the people to repress any social movements or protests. Now, back in 2006, of course, in the name of fighting narco gangs, but it's really to repress the social movements.
And before neocons think I am sounding like a brainwashed liberal and telling them documented fact, let me say that perhaps the piece of legislation most responsible for the influx of illegal immigration we see today, NAFTA, was signed into law by Democrat Bill Clinton. Another demonstration that at the top, the global cabal is in control of both of our nation's political parties, and therefore there is no hope of ever achieving real change within their paradigm. And while Trump campaigned on the idea that he would see to NAFTA being repealed, I'll believe it when I see it, and even then, it will be with great trepidation and apprehension, wondering if the globalists will use it, and Brexit, and other such things, to justify a staged economic collapse, whereby their goal of a one-world order will be realized, rising like a phoenix from its ashes. In the minds of most illegals, they are just trying to survive. If you think people are just coming here because they hate their own country and America is so great, you are utterly naive and bought into the propaganda being fed you. People of all kinds are naturally nostalgic for the place of their birth and do not want to leave their people or their homeland, especially to endure the hardship and fear inherent to the immigrant experience in the U.S.
You hear people that time saying the name Jesus, 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 but they're not living like Jesus.
Advocates say undocumented immigrants are treated like modern-day lepers, abandoned by church-going Americans living in the heart of the Bible Belt.
These people are not the one that created the problem. And again, we say people are here because somebody's offering their jobs. They are also here because they have to live where they were because they didn't have food. And even animals go from places and migrate to go where's food.
It's about survival.
It's about survival.
Un criminal?
No.
Tiene problemas con la policía?
No.
Paga taxos?
Sí.
Sí? Sin papeles?
Sí.
Sí. Social seguridad falso? Un carta falso?
Para
trabajar. La verdad, you see?
Sí.
Yeah. He pays taxes on somebody else's number. He's never going to get it. That's what he says. He's not a criminal. He's raising a good family, believes in God. I don't know. He's here. He ain't going. ¿Va a salir a México? No. No. He ain't going either. Why don't we get him to pay some taxes? Let him be.
They come here because jobs are offered, And because we have made sure, through economic policy and intervention into their governments, that their homelands stay at third world status where they could never achieve the relative prosperity and better life jobs here can afford them. We talk about prosperity while most of the rest of the world obsesses over how to stay alive and provide the basic necessities for those God has entrusted to their care. Build the wall. Just know that it is about as viable a solution to illegal immigration as gun control laws are to preventing violent crime. As one of the few gringos in this country who has worked as an agricultural laborer the vast majority of his life, often alongside immigrants from south of our border, I can tell you that when they were building the now largely defunct border fence, the Mexicans I worked with told me it was mostly Mexicans being hired to do the construction, and that there were places where tunnels were dug that the coyotes were told about and where the illegals crossed in at. And I guarantee you, like the old saying goes, where there's a will, there's a way. Any wall will be undermined in just the same fashion if it ever actually gets built. Somewhere along the line, they've convinced people on both sides of the political paradigm that economics is first and foremost, security is second, and morality is some distant afterthought if mentioned at all. But if your moral compass isn't set right, how are you going to correctly dictate anything else? That was perhaps the biggest hoax of this election. How we were being conditioned to think by the mainstream media and even the Republican establishment's apparent opposition to him, that Trump was somehow an outsider, not part of the club. This was the narrative pushed through one so-called alternative media source after another. I've heard from a source I trust, and there are not many I do trust, that upwards of 90% of the alternative media is disinfo. And I'll say it now publicly, as I've been saying privately the past year, pay attention to those media outlets claiming to be on the side of God and country that actively promoted Donald Trump. While there could be instances of unwitting ignorance, especially in the smaller outlets that basically follow the lead of the bigger outlets, this unabashed promotion of a false candidate as some sort of savior of the republic ought to be a huge red flag, cluing us into who these people are really working for. Stay tuned for an installment of the series exposing Alex Jones for the COINTELPRO agent of chaos he is. Consider the big piece of supposed evidence that was used to really seed this idea that Trump was an outsider.
And now they're faced with a very real prospect of Donald Trump becoming the leader of the party, and it absolutely drives them crazy. They just cannot
Why?
Imagine sharing. Well, because he's an outsider. He's not them. He's not part of the club. He's uncontrollable. You know, he hasn't been through the initiation rites. He didn't belong to the secret society. And I think that they don't see him. They have no idea how to relate to him.
I know you consider yourself a Catholic, but what happens when you worship Moloch at the Bohemian Grove? New York Post says that male prostitutes are shipped in into the Bohemian Grove. Can you tell us what happens there?
You actually believe all this junk?
The initiation rites. He didn't belong to the secret society.
You actually believe all this junk?
Bill Clinton said that Republicans run around naked in the woods there.
Did you say the Bohemian Club?
Yeah.
That's where all those rich Republicans go out and stand naked against redwood trees, right? I've never been to the Bohemian Club, but you ought to go. It'd be good for you. Get some fresh air.
And you don't want to know what Richard Nixon said about the place.
The Bohemian Grove that I attend. The Easterners and the others that come there. But it is the most faggot goddamn thing you can ever imagine on San Francisco crowd because it's just terrible. I mean, I have always shaken hands with everybody in San Francisco.
That's the place you attended. It's a secret society. Can you tell us at least who invited you?
You know, it's nice to know that there's some people who have fantasy lives.
Can I get a quick autograph here?
What's this picture of?
I actually don't remember.
It's you at the Bohemian Grove. Okay. You told me that I'm delusional.
You know, it's nice to know that there's some people who have fantasy lives.
It's you at the Bohemian Grove. Okay. You told me that...
And all the winds make merry with thy dust. Bring fire!
Now, the question must be asked, why would Newt Gingrich, a recent convert to the Roman Catholic Church, like other globalists such as Tony Blair and Jeb Bush, who is also a 33rd degree Freemason, CFR member, and attendee at the Bohemian Grove, a man immersed to his eyeballs in secret societies, be telling us Trump is not also involved in the same? Are we really supposed to believe he is telling us the truth?
He walked up to the temple with gold in his hand, and he bought off the priests and propositioned the land, and the world was his harlot and laid in the sand, while the band played 666. We served at his table and slept on the floor, but he starved us and beat us and nailed us to the door. Well, I'm ready to die, I can't take any more, and I'm sick of his lies and his tricks. He told us he loved us, that was a lie. There was blood in his pockets and death in his eyes. Well, my number is up and I'm willing to die if the band will play 666. If the band will play 666. If the band will play 666.
And what was really missed, and what Gingrich divulged, was the admission that secret societies are at work determining candidates and who is elected. He said it, unchallenged, right on mainstream media.
You know, there's an old saying, a saying my old man told me since I was a young kid, that I've seen stand the test of time. Show me your friends, and I'll show you who you are.
But Donald Trump, who's palled around with the Clintons for years, and other third and fourth tier operatives like the Wall Street bankers who have bankrupted this country, is somehow not connected? How naive must they think we are? And unfortunately, I don't see much evidence to prove their assessment of us as unwarranted. You don't get to be president of this country without having been initiated in the club. That's just the reality of the matter. They don't deny the truth, they make a joke out of it. Remember that Simpsons episode? Freemasons rule the country. It's chanted in a way to make it seem like a ridiculous idea.
Freemasons run the country!
But Freemasonry most certainly is the tie that binds those leading us into the globalist antichrist one world beast system. You see, I remember back in 2008 how Obama was promoted as this outsider, this new thing. There was so much dissatisfaction in the country, disillusionment. Even many conservatives voted for Obama because they were just so fed up with the Bush regime. And now, the shoe's on the other foot, and all these people that made fun of, you know, the woman with a Obama phone and all this are basically, you know, celebrating in the same fashion, like somehow Trump is gonna restore the country and give me back my republic. Are you blind? Haven't you paid attention at all? And what happened when Obama was in? How many of those campaign promises went right out the window? as he continued in all the policies of his predecessor. And now what do we see? Immediately, even before he's sworn in, Donald Trump talking about what a good guy Obama is. So if you're still watching, you've seen all this, and some of you most likely are not convinced that the fix is in. So since you're not convinced, I'd ask you to explain the following to me. Interesting, wasn't it, how we were told that a company linked to George Soros had its voting machines in several of the key swing states and was set to deliver the victory through voter fraud to Hillary Clinton. Listed among the 16 states were Wisconsin, where when it was called was listed as the point where Trump broke through the so-called blue wall, in Pennsylvania that sealed the deal for Trump. But if you recall back in 04 when there was empirical evidence of vote tampering, and few Christians that cared and fewer who complained because, after all, God's man had won, the machines were manufactured by Diebold and ES&S. To quote, the Republicans passed the Voting Act in 2002, authorizing the use of electronic voting machines with no requirement that they produce a paper receipt, a paper trail, which would allow an ironclad independent assessment of whether the data in the voting machines accurately reflected the votes cast. The Bush administration then ensured that the majority of these electronic voting machines were made by Diebold and ES&S. The president of one of these companies and the VP of the other are brothers. Both are staunch Republicans, and Diebold contributed hundreds of thousands of dollars to Republican campaigns. The CEO of Diebold was chairman of the Bush re-election campaign in Ohio and promised to deliver the state of Ohio to George Bush in the 2004 election. You can view Hacking Democracy, a nonpartisan documentary available for viewing on YouTube, demonstrating how voter fraud was rampant in 2004. This is all to say, the globalists get the person they want. Last one who bucked their aims was shot dead in the back of a limo. His brother, when it became apparent he would win, was shot dead in 68.
No one can be certain who next will suffer from some senseless act of bloodshed.
Robert Kennedy appealed to young and old, black and white, student and worker. Trying to end the violence that began with the murder of his brother. But as he speaks at this Los Angeles hotel, an assassin is waiting nearby.
My thanks to all of you, and now it's on to Chicago, and let's win there.
Senator Kennedy has been shot. Is that possible?
He is shot from behind three times, including quite blind behind the ear. Although rapidly losing blood, he says, is everyone else all right?
Get the gun. Stay away from the gun.
His hand is frozen. Take a hold of his thumb and break it if you have to. Get his thumb. All right. That's it, Raper. Get it. Get the gun, Raper. Hold him.
There are the writings of a maniac.
We don't want another.
There are the writings of Sirhan Sirhan.
Like it or not, we live in times of danger and uncertainty. That is the way he lived.
How did it seem to you when the senator
that
came
is what
to
he
press
leaves
the
us.
Oh, it's one of the greatest days we've ever had in this town.
We're enlarged in death beyond what he was in life.
Feel any differently after seeing it?
Be remembered simply as a good and decent
man. I feel
man.
A little prouder of being an American.
Saw wrong and tried to right it. Saw suffering and tried to heal it. Saw war and tried to stop it. Those of us who loved him and who take him to his rest today pray that what he was to us, what he wished for others, will someday come to pass for all the world. As he said many times, in many parts of this nation, those he touched and who sought to touch him. Some men see things as they are and say why. I dream things that never were and say why not.
But this is an intolerable condition. Reflects on all of us. We can do things all over the rest of the world, but I think we should do something for our people here in this, our own country.
Is love, sweet love, no, not just for some, but
So, the thinking person asks, given a rudimentary understanding of how easily rigged elections are, anywhere, anytime, and the fact so little rigging needed to be done were it deemed necessary to achieve a desired result, a handful of precincts in Pennsylvania, wasn't it? And the allegation Soros, who we're told backs Hillary all the way, owns the voting machines. Why do you suppose the globalists running this country, at the top on both sides, right and left of the Hegelian dialectic, allowed Trump to win?
At the center of George Soros, there's an inherent contradiction.
Which is,
on one hand, you're the capitalist who does not care about the social consequences of his act, and on the other hand, you are a philanthropist who cares only about social consequences. How do you resolve the two?
Recognizing that as a competitor, I've got to compete to win. As a human being, I am concerned about the society in which I live.
Which George Soros am I talking to now? The amoral George Soros or the moral George Soros?
It's one person. It's one person who at one time engages in amoral activities and at the rest of the time tries to be moral.
Are you religious?
No.
Do you believe in God?
No.
Soros told us he believes God was created by man, not the other way around, which may be why he thinks he can smooth out the world's imperfections.
George Soros, in a way, is Donald Trump without the humility.
One of your money manager told us that George really does think he's a god.
This is Mr. George Soros, and he's going to be helping you.
That the dice are loaded, everybody rolls with their fingers crossed. Everybody knows the war is over. Everybody knows the good guys lost. Everybody knows the fight was fixed. The poor stay poor, the rich get rich. That's how it goes. Everybody knows. Everybody knows that the boat is leaking. Everybody knows the captain lied. Everybody got this broken feeling, like their father or their dog just died. Everybody talking to their pockets. Everybody wants box of chocolates and the long stem rose. Everybody knows.
Other considerations. One, the fact that Bernie would have absolutely crushed Trump worse than he did Hillary, yet he told his supporters to stand down and get behind Hillary, even when it became exposed that Hillary and her company of thugs, thieves, and mercenaries had rigged the election against them. What can be logically concluded from this? Either the man is irrational or complicit. Either way, and regardless of what you personally think about his politic, he sold a lot of people down the river and enabled Trump's victory in the process.
What's been sickening more than one cycle since I've been paying attention to politics in my short life is how quickly seeming champions of the people will just suddenly turn on everyone, betray them, and endorse the very candidate that people would love to see exiled from the country and put on an island like Napoleon or something.
Most of you know this already, that our elections are bread and circuses. It's a big show. It gets everyone involved and makes them feel like they still have a voice in a completely corrupt, thoroughly corrupt system. Because this whole WikiLeaks thing came out and implicated the DNC in basically rigging the primaries against Bernie and for Hillary, something we all knew was going on, and it was really obvious. Come on, with the improbable coin tosses and card flips, it was a joke. It was a big joke. And everybody knew it. But now there's evidence of it in print. And no one is addressing this, least of all Bernie. He's basically taking it the same exact way Ron Paul took it. Continued to, of course, soak up campaign contributions, but just basically rolled over and took it. Because these people, whatever deal they have made, whatever part they are playing, that's already happened a long time ago. What's sad is that the people who stand behind these people don't understand that. You had Bernie pretty much booed almost completely off the stage yesterday.
We have got to defeat Donald Trump, and we have got to elect Hillary Clinton and Tim Kaine.
After he's basically booed off stage, what happened next is the mind-blowing part. You had Jane Sanders, Bernie's wife, walk up to the podium and say something to him that was caught on the hot mic. Check this out. They don't know your name is being put in nomination. That's the concern. See, they've tried to push the idea that Hillary is the presumptive nominee for weeks now, and Bernie has jumped right along onto that bus. Even at this moment, when he's up there addressing all of these supporters who have believed in him, he's not telling them that his name will be on the nomination. He's still going to be, it's not going to just be a piece of paper with a box on it that says Hillary Clinton, check here. That's not actually what's going on. He knows it, and he's standing up there telling them to vote for Hillary and not telling anyone anything. He's not addressing WikiLeaks, and he's not telling them that his name is going to be put in nomination. This, to me, is blatant obvious proof of his complicity in this whole thing since the beginning. And Hillary obviously knows the fix is in for her and has known forever.
I will be the nominee for my party, Chris. That is already done, in effect. There is no way that I won't be.
That's how easily we get played. They know the population gets angry, and it's a steam valve. It's a vent. Is it ever really real? Well, they always know they're just playing their part.
Hillary Clinton will make an outstanding president, and I am proud to stand with her tonight. Thank you all very much.
Attaboy, I knew he'd stay on script.
Two, the liberal media went way out of its way to demonize Trump, who was doing a good enough job of hanging himself at every turn. This motivated his followers and won him some converts and engendered sympathy, leading to people justifying even the unjustifiable, because, after all, the media is just picking on him. It became a thing in a lot of people's minds that, hey, the media lies to us, the media hates Trump, so let's stick it to the media and vote Trump. The leftist media had to know they were only helping Trump gain support, so why were they so overt with their attacks?
It's just incredible, the coordination of the media in attacking Trump, when first of all, ignoring him would work a lot better if they were really against him. And it's almost like it's reverse psychology. The system is hated. The people hate what the system have done. They're very angry. Everyone knows, obviously, the kind of crap the media is peddling and how they angle stories in ways that are untrue or deeply misleading, and they do it daily across all the networks, regardless of the leanings.
They have actually created a media, magical media window of nothing but anti-Trump coverage. Nothing but anti-Trump coverage. Like, there's nothing else going on in the world at all except how much everyone everywhere across the entire world hates Donald Trump.
Yes, Donald Trump may be the Republican frontrunner. I still think we're giving him way too much attention in proportion to the other candidates who also had victories to celebrate tonight.
And I'm not defending Trump. I don't trust Trump. But I get the anger behind his support. And I just think it's crazy. It makes me really angry to read the articles.
The bottom line is this: if they wanted Trump gone, if the elite was really declaring a war against Trump, they would simply ignore him. Like in The Simpsons, when the evil billboards came to life and the only way to stop them was to ignore them so they would go away. If they really wanted Trump gone, they would give him the amount of debate time
they gave Ron Paul.
Representing the 14th District of Texas, Congressman Ron Paul. Congressman Paul, let me follow up with you for just 30 seconds. Is it worth going to war to prevent a nuclear weapon in Iran?
No, it isn't worthwhile. And the only way you would do that is you'd have to go to the Congress. We as commander-in-chief, aren't making the decision to go to war. You know, the old-fashioned
way... that we're supposed to believe the level of ridiculousness that is coming out of our media right now, and our world leaders who are coming out against Trump, and all of these pundits and all these politicians, and this weird global coordinated anti-Trump response, because it's global now. They've got world leaders the world over coming out against Trump. The freaking Pope came out against Trump.
3. WikiLeaks could be ignored or marginalized by the mainstream media like it does everything that truly threatens a globalist agenda. Julian Assange could be taken out quite easily, even from the very beginning, were he a true threat, like all the other threats have been taken out. Yet, WikiLeaks gets nonstop coverage in a media utterly biased against Trump. And then they stage something where they cut out Assange's internet connection for a few days, as if to imply that Hillary had some sort of power to do that. And then they staged some assassination attempt on Trump days before the election to curry sympathy and to attempt to establish some sort of outsider credential to his image.
Go ahead, go!
Alex Jones goes on year after year, quote-unquote, exposing the leaders of the New World Order while promoting one shill after another. Yet William Cooper, who exposed Alex Jones as COINTELPRO, was gunned down at his home a month and a half after 9/11. So, there really is no rational way to conclude, despite what we are being led to believe, that Trump is somehow an alternative to the big club that has given us the Clintons and the Bushes and Reagan and Obama and all the rest. But when you expose how we the people are being played without offering a clear-cut strategy to taking the government back, whatever one might think that entails, you are subject to the charge of fatalism or defeatism. Let me be clear that what I am attempting to do here is anything but fatalism or defeatism. It is the very opposite. Let me ask you, would it be defeatism if you were a soldier and discovered your army had been subverted by the enemy, and that your generals were now in league with the enemy or even the enemy themselves, to desert and call for all true patriots to desert with you, lest they unwittingly find themselves serving the enemy in battle against those they enlisted to protect? Or would it be defeatism to realize you and your fellow soldiers were being led to the slaughter, fighting tanks, artillery, and machine guns with spears and swords, and called on them to abandon such futility and arm themselves appropriately? Defeatism would be to see how we were being played, both as patriots and as children of God, and then advocate to continue to embrace the Antichrist false candidates they are holding up for us as our political messiahs. To do so would also be insanity, in that it is doing the same things over and over again, expecting different results. We are not going to somehow affect real change within an utterly corrupt political system arrayed in direct opposition to God, under the control of those who are only after power and the control of the people. But the reality is, the days of the pilgrims are over. There is nowhere else to go to escape from their system. We must instead resort to emulating the first century church, who persevered even under the persecution of pitiless tyrants such as Nero. I offer as a counter-strategy the strategy of the Apostle Paul, who lived in those days and suffered mightily for his faith under the cruelest of oppression. Pray for our leaders, he said. I do not discount that God could lay his hand on Trump and use him in spite of himself. God could even humble him and save him and use him to truly oppose the Antichrist system. But as it stands, I cannot support a man who itches ears and compromises at every turn and flip-flops for the sake of political expediency and works to affect the New World Order while being promoted as a candidate that will oppose it. Given what he has said in the past, there is no rational reason to believe Trump will do anything to get Roe overturned so that the horrific slaughter of the unborn can be legally recognized for the criminal act it truly is. And there is certainly no reason to believe he will ever overturn the revisionist definition of what constitutes a marriage, or oppose the ludicrous idea that anyone can just decide what gender they are and use the bathroom of their choice. This will lead others to conclude I am then calling for a theocracy. Wrong. Dead wrong. I believe wholeheartedly in the separation of church and state, but let us remember that while the nation was not formed as a Christian nation from the beginning of its independent government, the Constitution most certainly was a product of a social framework informed by Christian principle, a framework that no longer exists. It would never have come out of a secular society that held the Bible to be a work of fiction instead of a guide to man from his creator. The Communist Manifesto is the best such a godless society could ever muster. One document is intended to protect life and the God-given rights inherent to it in the context of the common welfare. The other proposes a way of leveling all things with man as arbiter. This has led to atrocity, genocide, and a host of other horrors. One document is founded on the bedrock of adherence to divine principle, and one document was sold on basis of trying to effect justice through the economy. Sound familiar? Let us not forget, Marx was influenced by Adam Smith as well. The reality is that corporate fascism and communism are cousins evolved from the same flawed root, the same Genesis 3 lie of man as essentially his own God. I do not believe there is hope of liberty and justice for all in a state commanded by those who think reality can be reinvented. Calling an unborn child a blob of cells does not then mean you have made it less of a human being. Thinking two people in love, whatever concept of love you may have, is what makes for a marriage does not mean that is actually what defines a marriage. Love, as defined by 1 Corinthians 13, is what is in place for a marriage to operate as God designed it. But it is not the definition itself. There is a reason we do not recognize an adult and a child or two siblings or a human and an animal as married, even if it is claimed both love each other. Likewise, two people of the same gender. It is because the definition of marriage from the beginning was one man and one woman. It is a sacred social construct God has ordained for the propagation of societies and the nurture and protection of their young. This is why the devil, hating life because it comes from God and he hates God, is relentless in his attacks on the family. He would have the state raise a society's young, and the state be led by those who would reinvent reality so as to reinvent the family, so as to destroy lives.
This country was founded by dangerous men.
Amen.
And the moment the people in this country cease to be dangerous men, it's going to be the day we cease to have a country. Their whole goal with this philosophy is to teach all men and women that the only end of life is to seek the utmost pleasure and happiness that you can get out of it, because when you die, there's nothing else. That's what they teach. That's what they want you to be. That's why they don't want laws against sexual promiscuity. That's why they don't want families. That's why they don't want marriage. That's why they encourage homosexuality. There's a method to their madness. There's really not much method to yours, because you're operating from a place of ignorance. And until you change that, you're going to be bumbling around, bumping into each other, saying and doing the wrong things, not understanding the nature of your enemy. And if you don't understand the nature of your enemy and the weapons they use, you cannot fight that enemy. You can't fight the battle. You shouldn't even be on the battlefield. That's why you're losing the war.
Mr. Keyes, on the Channel 7 debate last Thursday night, you said, and I'm quoting you, where procreation is in principle impossible, marriage is irrelevant. You went on to say it was irrelevant and not needed. What about marriage between people who are well beyond their childbearing age? Irrelevant, not needed?
No, simply a misunderstanding. The word in principle means
relating to the definition of, not relating to particular circumstances. So if an apple has a worm in it, the worm is not part of the definition of the apple. It doesn't change what the apple is in principle. So the fact...
It retains its appleness.
To act as if concepts are laughable means that you want to be irrational. Human beings by means of concepts and definition. We also make laws by means of definitions. And if you don't know how to operate with respect for those definitions, you can't make the law. An individual who is impotent or another who is infertile does not change the definition of marriage in principle. Because between a man and a woman, in principle, procreation is always possible. And it is that possibility which gave rise to the institution of marriage in the first place. As a matter of law and government, it's still possible in principle. But when it is impossible, as between two males or two females, you're talking about something that's not just incidentally impossible, it's impossible in principle. And that means that if you say that that's a marriage, you are saying marriage can be understood in principle apart from procreation. You have changed its definition in such a way as, in fact, to destroy the necessity for the institution. Since the only reason it has existed in human societies and civilizations was to regulate, from a social point of view, the obligations and responsibilities attendant upon procreation. So when you start playing games in this way, you are actually acting as if the institution has no basis independent of your own arbitrary whim.
Evidence abounds that children are best served to have both a loving father and mother in the home. All other ideas are vain and failed attempts to reinvent reality that are as insane as a person who has the empirical evidence of his or her sex organs and yet thinks that by mental power, he or she can then reinvent themselves as the opposite gender. Note that this is in no way a call to criminalize homosexuality or persecute those identifying as LGBT. It is merely saying, have your unions, indulge in your lifestyle if you are convinced that is what is right for you, and you do not harm others in so doing. But what you do not have the right to do is try to act like it is your right to reinvent reality for the rest of us. The reason they are called rights in the first place is because they are the God-given freedom and responsibility to do that which is right. Calling that which is opposed to reality a right only leads to tyranny against those whose rights must be trampled on in order to create your new reality. There are numerous ways to get marriage wrong, among heterosexuals also. But to use the failure of following God's order for an institution he has ordained as rationale for discounting it so as to redefine it would be like saying a child's safety seat is unsafe because you disregarded the instructions it came with and failed to secure it in place with a seatbelt. There was nothing wrong with the design of the safety seat. What was wrong was the way in which it was being implemented. To then say because some people might fail to properly secure a child's safety seat, we ought to just strap children to the roof if we feel like it, would be insane. Abortion robs the liberty of the unborn person to live and is therefore injustice. Homosexual union as marriage is the equivalent of a thief being allowed to rob a jeweler. Marriage is not free for the taking for what is not, by definition, marriage. Calling a piece of grass a rose does not mean I have then turned it into a rose. Marriage ought to be protected per what it actually is, for the good of society, regardless of divorce rates, and reinventing what a woman is so that I have no legal recourse to prevent any pervert who decides he can follow my wife or daughters into a bathroom does not make for justice to those I have been in charge by God to protect. And despite whatever flip-flops Trump may have thrown to the evangelicals he relied on to win the election, it is clear that the man in his heart approves of reinventing reality on all three fronts, and to promote him and support him, as so many have done, is to be complicit in this, which can only be called what it is, an affront to God, a way of spitting in his face by rejecting the order he has instilled into his creation. Self-professing Christians of the official Church of Germany were not guiltless of Hitler's actions for choosing to stick their heads in the sand and ignore what the man was about and instead allow themselves to be swept along by all his grand rhetoric about how he would rescue them from the encroaching communist menace and restore their nation to greatness. And yes, I went there because the analogy is valid. It must be said, reinventing reality is not without real consequences. It is like if I decided my reality was that a brick wall was invisible and I tried to drive my car through it at 100 miles an hour. The very real consequence would result in the destruction of the car and likely end up in my death. This is why that mantra I kept hearing from the religious right about vote Trump, regardless of his moral character, because after all, we're not electing a pastor, falls flat. I don't care how good he may or may not be on the economy. If you are being led by a man who believes it is his right to reinvent reality and go along with those who do, you are headed for destruction just as surely as the nation of Israel was destroyed after years of turning its back on what God had ordained and the commandments he set forth for their true peace and security, that they might be blessed rather than suffer the curse inherent to attempting to reinvent reality. No, we do not need a pastor or even a Christian to lead this country, and I most certainly advocate for the separation of church and state. But we cannot afford to be led by someone reinventing reality. And if such a person is what is provided for the nation by the forces of Antichrist, and is who the nation places over it through election, and is allowed to lead a nation turning its back on God as a judgment against it, then our only recourse is to call it out for what it is, and to abstain from evil rather than allow ourselves to be ensnared in it through complicity. This isn't fatalism. This isn't defeatism. This is a call to true Christians, the people of the book, followers of the living God, to understand the tactics of our enemy, the devil, and those who serve him, so that we be not deceived and keep ourselves from unwitting promotion of great evil as we see the day of the Lord approaching, where all wrongs will be put right. That, and only that, is how we occupy until he comes. It is a call to fight the battle where the battle is at. This is not a call to abandon the political realm, but if we are to labor in it, then let us raise up candidates that do not compromise with evil, who do not reinvent reality, and vote for them, even if the entire political apparatus opposes and marginalizes them.
I do want to get one final thing off my chest, because if I don't, then I'm not being a sincere brother with you. I have seen the church compromise so much in the last month and a half, and that is the part that depresses me. When I make these videos, know that I'm not making them because I'm simply bored and I have nothing to do. As your brother in the Lord, and I'm sure that I share the sentiments of other video makers who have been standing up for the Word of God on YouTube, and we have a life outside of here. We work a full-time job and we try to do the best we can to make sure that we're not a burden to you financially or in any other way. So when we take time to make a video, spend hours making a video, it's because we genuinely care about you. And it's very easy for me to go with the grain and go with what's popular. But I have to warn you as your brother in the Lord. I have to. If not, then I'm not being right by God. If that makes some of you upset, I can't apologize for that. But I do want to say that when you see a person on the screen promoting sodomy, what most people call homosexuality, with the flag, you denounce that and you call it a sin. And you in love call that person to repentance. When Donald Trump does it, you look the other way. When Disney, PayPal, and many other companies came up against Georgia and came up against North Carolina, when Target told you that they were now going to accept transgenders in their restrooms and promote the sodomy agenda, you boycotted it as Christians. You spoke against it as Christians. In fact, James Dobson spoke against it and even said that he was not going to support Trump because of it, because of the Supreme Court ruling.
For us, the sanctity of human life and traditional marriage are non-negotiable, non-negotiable. Ted has been relentless in defending the institution of the family. After Donald Trump and Marco Rubio announced that they would accept the Supreme Court's ruling on gay marriage, we knew we could not support them. Our decision was confirmed when they opposed Senator Cruz's efforts to defund Planned Parenthood.
But in the end, just as the cookie crumbles, James Dobson gave in and supported Trump as well.
Hi, I'm Dr. James Dobson, and I know that many of you are deeply concerned, as I am, about the direction our country is headed. We're losing ground as a nation every day. And that's why I've decided as a private individual to endorse Donald J. Trump for President of the United States.
I am praying for Donald Trump to actually do good. It would be an evil thing for me to root for him to do bad. It would be a very wicked thing. But as you've already seen, there's a lot of compromises already happening, and a lot of the alternative news media like Alex Jones and others who promoted Trump are turning a blind eye to it too. They don't want to talk about all of the things that he's already doing. So as a church, I ask of you, I beg of you that we learn to actually call people to repentance.
It seems pretty apparent to me, as what I see already playing out, which is kind of ironic. These people, these God-haters and these secular anarchists and communists that are taking in the streets, they should have been, if anything, they should have been riot in the streets when Hillary stole the thing from Bernie Sanders. I mean, these people that are out in the streets, they don't realize that Donald Trump is one of their own. They don't understand that. And the Christians, the ones without any representation whatsoever in this government, somehow don't understand that he is Antichrist. They're going to use Donald Trump to energize the secularists, the God-haters, and all the rest to come back with a fury that is ramped up exponentially. And guess what? Who it's going to be targeted at? All those who gave Trump support.
We're gonna go after him in every conceivable way. And so they think I'm the enemy. Yeah, goddamn right I'm your enemy. You know, as you look around here and everybody is mad, etc., a little galvanized, right?
And look what the media is doing. They're tagging the evangelical Christians as the ones who got Trump elected. And it's true. He couldn't have done it without you. Not legally. Christianity is going to be targeted because of how easily so many self-professing Christians traded in their moral compasses for political expediency when the vast majority of them knew better and yet supported this man and his immorality anyway. Anything but Hillary, right? How do you know you haven't gotten something far worse than Hillary? How do you know that? You who knew who this man was and is and what he stood for, who slowly by degrees let your brand of the media, whether left, right, or alternative, sell you on the ridiculous concept that he is somehow an outsider, that he will somehow restore the republic and protect national sovereignty, it is you who have the most to answer for. The secularists and the pagans and the God-haters are at least consistent in their backing of evil. But you know better. And yet you continue to support and even promote these antichrist, one-world false candidates and thereby advance the Hegelian dialectic, boiling our society like a frog on the stove, selling your children and my children's future to the devil. Because you just don't want to know. You don't want to unplug from their mind control. You don't want to deny their mental manipulation of you and realize what time it is. And because of that, like the good book says, God's people are destroyed for lack of knowledge, and we will all reap what has been sown. I'll tell you now, before most of you realize it, if you ever do, that the blood is on your hands. And will be upon the hands of your children. Give us Barabbas, you have cried, and Barabbas you have received. Somewhere along the line, many people claiming to be of God have forgotten that the lesser of two evils is still evil, and that Christ has no fellowship with Belial any more than light has fellowship with darkness or truth with lies. Where are the children of light and truth? What compromise is there with evil? Have you forgotten what kingdom we serve? I'm just sick of seeing God's people getting used and allowing themselves to be used and manipulated by the devil's minions. A lot of Christians will run to 2 Chronicles 7:14 every time a new abomination is legalized by one of these Luciferian charlatans. And some of them are the same people pushing Trump as some sort of political savior.
It's important that we focus on the positive towards the people and not focus on all this, his lawsuits. I mean, I know it's news. I know it's news. But people have to kind of, again, like before the election, I said, let's focus on who's the right person. That decision's been made. Now we have to do our best to just continue to positively try to do unto others as you would have them do unto you. Okay. Great, great verse in 2 Chronicles, brother. If my people would humble themselves and pray, I would hear their pray, and I would hear their prayer, and I would heal their land. That's a powerful thought.
But I have to ask, do you suppose God is the kind of father who gives his children snakes when they ask for bread? Is Christ going to send his body Antichrist as provision? Don't you see how they're using God's people in their devilish game? They need you. They need you to keep participating and supporting the so-called lesser of two evils. That's how the good cop, bad cop routine works. It's the Hegelian dialectic. That's how the devil advances his kingdom. Little by little, he gets you to accept what you would have never accepted in the first place. And as you continue to promote the lesser evil, you continue to slide further and further from the good. And pretty soon, your lesser evil is far more evil than even the greater evil you first accepted a lesser evil to oppose.
They experimented at Cornell University some years ago by putting a frog in a dishpan of boiling water, and he jumped out. And then they put a frog in a dishpan of cold water, and they turned the jet at the bottom, and then they turned it up 1 degree, 2 degrees. And you know what that frog did? He stayed in there till they cooked him to death. When they put him in the boiling water, he got out because he said, I can't live here. But when they, by degrees, they changed the thing, and he adjusted, and he adjusted, and he adjusted, and they still killed him anyhow. And you know, we've got some things in our churches, if not in our lives, that a few years ago we never would have had. And old Satan didn't pour the boiling water on. He put this little thing, and then that little thing, and that little thing. And before very long, the churches become so carnal. The glory of the Lord doesn't fill the temple. When did you last tiptoe out of your particular tabernacle saying, surely God is in this place? I say again with all the power of my being, I do not believe that modern Christians go to church to meet God. They go to church to hear a sermon about God. They don't expect deity to invade the place. They don't expect to tiptoe out of the holy place saying, God is the here and that to bless us. The Spirit moved over my heart. A boy said to me a sweet thing this morning. He's only a young fellow, 17 or 18, I guess. And he said, Brother Ragnall, it's been so good to be here this week. You know, during the preaching, and a number of priests besides me. But he said, during the preach, the Lord has been pushing back my horizons. Well, God bless him. I'm glad for fellows that have got bigger horizons. You know, David prayed, enlarge my heart. Some of us are praying, enlarge my head. But David didn't pray, enlarge my head. He says, enlarge my heart. And if he enlarges my heart, he'll enlarge my vision, he'll enlarge my compassion, he'll enlarge my concern.
Behind him, he shows an iron tree with a pointed glass thing.
just want to hear this. Yeah, we've got all sorts of schools of peace. You know, the worst thing that happens to the church is not even when it becomes rich. I said to you the other day that I like my definition by Dr. J.B. Phillips. He's not his English anyhow, but J.B. Phillips has a summary of the Acts of the Apostles, which is superb. He sees the whole of the Acts of the Apostles sliding with life. Why? Because the love of God was never brought in their hearts. J.B. Phillips comes up the early church in Acts of the Apostles 5 verse. He says, this is the church of Jesus Christ. Before it became shocked from the beginning, before it became fat and short and fed by prosperity. This is the church of Jesus Christ before it became muscle bound by over organization. This is common, this is the church of Jesus Christ. Well, they didn't gather together a bunch of intellectuals to study psychosomatic medicine, making a mistake. This is the church of Jesus Christ, but they did not say prayers, but they prayed in the Holy Ghost. No wonder they were an embarrassment to Romans. No wonder they turned the world upside down. Meditate on the smooth, gentle atmosphere we're in. He said he'd just been in a church, he told me. It was a cold winter night. It was a pretty cold winter last winter. These both felt in hell. And he came up and stood up and said, my dear friend, this Wednesday night, I want to thank you from the bottom of my heart for coming to church. It is a terrible night. The wind is blowing and it's most uncomfortable. And you've come to church. Oh, you're so wonderful. He was prepared to rapture them and give them all a crowd right on the spot. They were so marvelous that they come to church. And he said, I want to thank you from the depths of my... Oh, he laid it on, and the old boy there was right this all the time. When he got up, he said, I'm glad to be here tonight. And I would like to add my personal gratitude that you people left your central heated homes and got in your beautiful heated cars and came to this heated church to sit on these nice soft pews, whereas when I am in Africa, a man will walk 15 miles to church and often have to stop to get thorns out of his feet and often out of his life because there are lions there. I often have danger crossing a river because of my you know what they are, those ugly things. And then on top of that, crocodiles. And he said, you know what? They walk 15 miles home at night and they haven't got a bite of food when they get there. And you lush people left your warm homes for your warm cars for a warm church and beautiful seats. He said, I'm going to beat for that. I'll be going so up first. You'll make me sick. Now maybe that's a bit of it, that's an exaggeration that actually happened. You see, the softer you get, oh, aren't we wonderful? I sometimes wonder what will happen when persecution really does come. How many of us will stand the test? And we've got what it takes. You can't love theology, you can't love a creed, you can only love a living person who is Jesus Christ. Nothing that when this man bear his back to the smiters, hang on a piece of wood in the Mediterranean for 36 hours, in weariness, in fastings, in painfulness, in tribulation, in distress, in famine, in peril, in nakedness, in sword, in peril to the deep, in peril to my own countrymen, God. And he exalts everything the devil can shoot at him, and he comes up smiling at the end of it. He says, you know what? They're never going to treat me better than they treated him. And if they treated the Son of God by what they expect to have it. But I want to tell you something, I've got something inside of me and I won't break up under it. Because the love of God again is shed abroad in my heart by the Holy Ghost.
Choosing rather to suffer affliction. Come on, you idiot. Sit down and count the cost. Choosing rather to suffer affliction. with the children of God and to enjoy the pleasures of sin. Come on. I remember the first time I was in an Alliance meeting and they sang a hymn, "To Be Like Jesus." Oh, I want to be like Jesus. And immediately I thought, do you? Do you really? You want 40 days in the wilderness with the devil? You want to be considered mad by your relatives? Would you really like a Judas in your life? Would you like a Thomas in your life that would doubt you? Do we want to be like him? He was the master of a situation like this. His strength is made perfect in weakness. Somebody slapped him on the jaw. He could have breathed on him and shrunk him like a fly dying. He never exercised his authority for his own defense or his own success. You men that have beards, somebody plucked your jaw and grabbed that and pulled the flesh out, you'd jump. They did that to him. Somebody got a mouthful of phlegm and spit in his face and in his eye. Doesn't do a thing. Come on, you idiot. Sit down and count the cost.
You can't love theology, you can't love a creed, you can only love a living person who is Jesus Christ.